Okay. Afternoon, everyone. Thanks very much for joining me. Before we set off, just a couple of little bits of housekeeping. I have got the windows open because it gets very hot when the minibus is full. If you need to open the window further, you just twist the little knob and the window slides quite easily. If it gets too noisy outside and you want to close one, same thing. Okay, in about a minute's time, the minibus will make a slightly disconcerting noise, as if you've all been locked in. You haven't been locked in. Other people have been locked out, though. That's what's going on. But if it came to it, well, there are these two emergency hammers if we have to break a window to get out. But it's not come to that yet. I think we'll be all right. Okay, I think we're about ready. This is to Mrs. Margaret Radcliffe, 76 Norman Road, Walsall, West Midlands, WS5 3QN. Letter number one. Wednesday, the 21st of September, 1988. He gets a lift with his son from his home in Walsall, which is in England, to Digbeth coach station in Birmingham, also in England. He waits to the last minute to join the queue to board the coach, the 11 a.m. to Glasgow, which is in Scotland. And he's second to last on board. The coach is full and he does not get a double seat to himself. The journey to Glasgow is uneventful, save for the presence of two dogs, one of whom a West Highland Terrier, who is clearly up for a bit of bother. He sits next to a man of about 30, and the man tells him that he is A, unemployed, B, unable to afford the £6 needed to join the Youth Hostel Association, C, going to Glencoe for 2 weeks and is staying in a bunkhouse because that's cheaper than a hostel, and D, unable to afford any more bus fares. He drinks two coffees in the 6 hours it takes to get to Glasgow. He shares his sandwiches with the unemployed man. There are long delays on the A74 around Ecclefechan, as they say. The coach is late into Glasgow, so he has to board the Inverness coach straight away, and again the coach is full. He sits next to an old woman in her 80s who spends the journey smoking extremely long cigarettes and coughing. The old lady asks him if he minds her smoking. He smiles and says, of course not. He eats his apple, banana and Kit Kat. This coach has no buffet service, so he has a couple of swigs from his flask. One outside the Fisher's Hotel in Pitlochry, where he drinks a toast to his friend Harry, and another as he passes Dalwhinnie. It is a beautiful evening in Inverness when they arrive at 9:30. He struggles up the hill with his haversack to the hostel, and the hostel is full. All 240 bunks. He's given the address of a Mrs. Law who will be able to provide him with bed and breakfast or pass him on to someone else if she is full. He walks for 10 minutes and he finds the house. It is dark. He rings the doorbell twice, and when Mrs. Law answers the door, she's wearing a dressing gown. She's not taking people in tonight because she's got to be up early to go to Aberdeen. They agree that he will be up as early as needed in order to let her do this. She says she won't bother with breakfast and it will only be £5 for the night. She shows him to the bathroom and to a neat downstairs bedroom with three single beds. She reminds him that she has to be out early. He tells her to wake him as early as she needs to. At 8:30 the next morning, she brings him a cup of tea and some rich tea biscuits. Snack time, she says, and they talk for an hour. She tells him about the Chinese girls who stayed the night before, who had shown her how to write her name, Mrs. Law, very common in China, in Chinese characters. She tells him about her 96-year-old mother in a nearby home, about her son and grandson near Aberdeen, about her son and two grandchildren near Derby, about her brother who doesn't do his share of looking after their mother, about her friend who has just moved back to Inverness with a husband after 40 years in England. He tells her how he and his wife have talked about moving back to Scotland, but with their children and their grandchildren all nearby in Walsall, it's too hard to up and leave. She says, my friend and her husband were glad to get away from all of their family down there in England. When he leaves at 9:30, he apologises for delaying her. She says not to worry, as her husband is still out in the shed doing a wee job. He likes the house. He decides that he would go back there, even if he had to share it with two others. He leaves in good spirits and on good terms. He buys two potato scones and a wholemeal loaf, and he rushes onto the train to Laigue, where he plans to have a pub lunch. The train is quiet, and when the buffet trolley comes round, he buys a coffee and a packet of rich tea biscuits. In Laigue, there's no time for a pub lunch. He does post a postcard to Margaret, his wife, and then he boards the Durness bus, a new Rapson's post bus, and the bus is full of boxes and bundles of papers, magazines, parcels, mail, which are all unloaded at the post offices they pass on their way through the highland towns and villages. It's wild, rocky country. Not many people. Lots of sheep. And one other passenger, a girl of about 20, who gets off at Kinloch Burvey. For lunch, he has his two dry potato scones, three dried apricots, two squares of plain chocolate, and a swig from his flask. He arrives in Durness just after 5 p.m. He walks 1 mile up the hill to the hostel, and the hostel is full, but including him. 16 blokes and 4 girls, 6 cyclists all travelling alone, and a German girl whose birthday it is. The German girl phones a family, but she doesn't get any reply. He gives her a Mars bar and a Durness postcard with happy birthday written on the front in biro. She smiles and says thank you. He waits until the kitchen is less busy, about 7:30, and then he makes himself sardines on toast, ginger preserve on toast, and Abernethy biscuits for his tea. The German girl phones home and she gets a reply this time, so she's happier now. At 10 p.m, he sits down and he writes down his travels as a letter to his wife Margaret. He signs off TTFNH. Ta-ta for now, Henry. And Henry Radcliffe was Scottish. He was born in Glasgow, where he grew up, and where he met Margaret and married her in 1945. They started their family in Glasgow, two sons and an older daughter who would grow up to be my mum. And sometimes the children would go and stay with relatives in Dundee because the house was small. But eventually they all moved to Dublin in Ireland, and then to Walsall in Staffordshire in England, where their children grew up, had children of their own, and didn't leave. This isn't a picture of Henry. Yeah. This is a picture of a postcard that he sent me at least 8 times during my childhood, pretty much every summer without fail. He would always claim it was a picture of him, though, like in disguise, and he'd always write something like, "Dear Alexander, this is me, your granddad. I am the greatest. Love from granddad." He had a heart attack in his late 50s, and he took early retirement. And after he'd retired, and after it became clear that my nanny was never going to move back to Scotland away from her grandchildren, my granddad began what my mum refers to as his jaunts, these solo expeditions back up to Scotland, always to somewhere he'd not been to before. And I remember him telling me about one of these jaunts really clearly. I was 19, he was 62, and he'd just got back from Cape Wrath, which is the most northwesterly point of mainland Britain, the top left-hand corner of Scotland, if you like. We were sitting in the kitchen, around the kitchen table, which was laden with food, as it always was when there were visitors. My nanny was there, and I was visiting with my dad. And this is the story of the journey that I remember him telling me that afternoon. He'd got a lift into Birmingham with his son, his youngest son, also called Henry, and then he'd got public transport as far north up the east coast as he could. And when the public transport ran out, he started to hitchhike. And his first lift was with a postman whose route went past Cape Wrath. So his first lift took him exactly where he wanted to go, but it took ages because the postman stopped at every farmhouse that he delivered to and went in for a cup of tea and a chat. I don't know that my granddad went in for a cup of tea and a chat as well, but I can't really imagine that he was left outside in the van. When they got to Cape Wrath, the postman told my granddad that he would be back on that road in about 2 hours' time, so we could pick him up on his return journey if he wanted. And my granddad said, "So I went and I sat on the cliff, I looked at the sea, and I thought about my life." And sure enough, 2 hours later, the postman came back, picked him up at the roadside, and my granddad went home. And after we left my nanny and granddad's that day, my dad said something to me that I've always remembered. He said that listening to my granddad talk about sitting on the cliff and looking at the sea made him think that my granddad was a man who was happy, who was content with his life and everything that had happened in it. My granddad died in 2008, and when I spoke at his funeral, I talked about the image I have of him in my head, sitting up there at Cay Wrath, looking at the sea, thinking about his life. And after the funeral, I kept thinking about that journey and how I wanted to retrace it, reenact it, to follow in his footsteps, I suppose. And so I got out a map of Scotland to figure out how I would actually get there. Now, I love maps. I don't need much of an excuse to get out a map, particularly a map of Scotland. I'd happily just read the place names, I think. I haven't got enough for one each, but we could probably do one per row, I think, if you don't mind sharing. It'd be easier. Can I give you two that one? I'm going to squeeze through. If I give you guys that one. If you open them all the way up, so you get a sense of where we are. If you like, share them across the aisle, maybe. And I'm just going to squeeze in at the back here and share with you. So you'll probably spot Cay Wrath pretty quickly. So I'm sure a lot of you are very familiar with this sort of map, but just in case you're not, the way we can find our way around it is use like a simple version of the grid reference system. You see the numbers that run along the top and along the side of the map. So if you count along the top, top of the map to, let's say, number 43, and then you count down to 60, you'll find yourself in the middle of Loch Erribon. That's one of my favourites. Although I heard recently that the American soldiers call it Loch Horrible. But some of the place names up here, actually, I'd like the look of them, but I don't know how you would say them. If you count along the top to number 23 and down to 69, you see in that square there, see the little outcrop of rock? What's that called?
Some Klingon, isn't it?
I don't think so. Well, there's too much punctuation in it for a start, I think. A couple of the places we do need to have a look at, slightly more usefully. If you count along the top to number 40 and down to 68, you'll find Durness. Has everyone got that?
Yeah.
And then one square east of Durness, you'll see Sango Bay, which has got an award-winning beach. And one square west of Durness, you'll see Balnakeel Craft Village. Two squares north of the Craft Village, you'll see Balnakeel Bay. And if you come two squares south of the Craft Village and go two squares west, you'll find yourself in the middle of the Kyle of Durness. And you'll see that there's a ferry route goes across the Kyle, just in the summer, passenger ferry. And where it rejoins the mainland, that ferry route, you see it's a double dotted line. That means it's a single track road. And that single track road goes through a danger area. Mm-hmm. And that's because the Ministry of Defence own this land. And they practice their war games up here with live ammunition. You see the danger area actually goes out over the sea as well. I don't know if that's just because they're like a bad shot. Or maybe there are submarines involved. But if you follow the single track road, you'll see it ends up at Cay Wrath, and in amongst the rocks, you'll see a symbol for a lighthouse. And the road up there is actually a dead end. And actually, it's a dead end back at the ferry port.
Just goes from there to there.
Yeah, it is part of the National Road Network, but it just doesn't connect to any other road. So Cay Wrath isn't somewhere you can drive past. It's not somewhere you can be dropped off by a postman who will pick you up on his way back. Because where would he be coming back from? Looking at this map, I realised that the story of the journey that my family had always told was maybe not quite the whole truth. So what I did is I dug out my granddad's diaries, which I've got in the form of two big photo albums that he made up after my nanny died, that tell the story of their lives together. And these albums, they contain all of the letters and all of the postcards that he sent to her when he was off on his jaunts. And that's how I figured out what the journey that I actually had to recreate was. So your job, everybody, is to fold these maps up correctly, please. That's folded up correctly.
I'm not being fun.
That was unfair of me to leave you with that one on your own.
I'm still going. I'm there.
Thank you. So, my trip to Cairbrath started on the Wednesday, the 21st of September 2011. I got a lift with my family to Meadow Hall, or Meadow Hell, as we refer to it locally. And then I walked over the footbridge, over the River Don, and down to the coach station, where I was getting the 10:30 coach from Sheffield to Inverness. 10:30 coach from Sheffield has actually started in London first thing that morning. And by the time this one got to Sheffield, it was exactly half full. Each double seat had got one person sitting in it, and everyone was guarding the seat next to them with their bag and a coat. Some people were pretending to be asleep across two seats. And I realised that what I was going to have to do is I was going to have to annoy somebody by sitting next to them, by stealing their double seat from them. And then I was going to have to sit next to somebody who I'd annoyed for possibly 8 hours all the way to Inverness. So I stood in the middle of the aisle and I kind of made a bit of a fuss about taking my bag off and taking my coat off and looking round for somewhere to sit, thinking that, you know, people would notice that and someone would free up a seat. But everyone just ignored me and stared straight ahead. So I looked around for the least protected seat, and there was a woman who'd just got a cagoule on the seat next to her. That's easy. Sorry, could you just move that? And she just moved the cagoule without even looking at me, without saying anything. So, coach set off north up the M1, and after a couple of junctions, the coach pulled off the motorway, turned round and rejoined the M1 heading south. And I thought, this isn't the way to Scotland. And other people were clearly thinking the same thing, but none of us said anything to each other. We just sat and worried about it on our own, because we're British. And then the coach pulled into a service station, and there were passengers at the service station waiting to get on the coach. Pedestrians at the service station. How had they got to the service station? But the driver didn't seem fazed by this at all. He just let them on, and then he got off and he made a phone call, and then he got back on. He said, right, you've got a 15-minute break now, because the next driver, he's not in any hurry today. Unscheduled 15-minute coffee and cake break. So most of us piled into the services and got supplies. And when people got back onto the coach, everyone was, well, it'd be overstating it to call it a party atmosphere, but people were definitely chattier and got talking to each other. And I got talking to a cagoule lady as we set off, and the coach turned round and started going north again. And a cagoule lady had meant to be on the last coach out of London the night before, but she'd got to Victoria coach station just in time to see her coach disappear through the shutters. Then she had to spend the night in Victoria coach station and then get the dawn coach the next day. She was a teacher. She taught English as a foreign language. And I was really interested in that. And I asked her, which nationality finds English the hardest to learn? And she said, well, that's the wrong question, because it's got nothing to do with your nationality. It's all to do with your age. It's much easier to learn foreign languages when you're young. So she teaches lots of children. She runs courses all over Britain, and she has children sent to her from all over the world. She told me about this one little boy whose mum had put him on a plane in Moscow to Heathrow on his own, and she'd given him enough cash to just get a taxi straight from Heathrow to the course. The course was in Lancaster, £360 taxi ride, and the little boy was only 8, and by the time the taxi driver dropped him off, he told her that he'd been crying for the last hour of the journey because he was so far from home. Oh. when we got into Newcastle, it was Cagoule Ladies Stop. I asked her a name, and she told me her name was Sandy. I told her my name was Alex, and we said goodbye. North out of Newcastle, over the Scottish border, which is marked by Scottish flags. I don't think there are any English flags, I think it's just Scottish flags. And then into Edinburgh, where we had a scheduled 15-minute break. I went looking for espresso, as usual. And when I got back to the coach, the big luggage doors were still open down the side of the coach, and there were three bags out on the concrete. And one of the bags was mine. And I said to the driver, "That's my bag." And the driver said, "Is it?" Well, we had to take all of the bags off. We were looking for a bad smell. We found the bad smell. But now we're only putting the bags back on when we know who they belong to. And I said, "Well, that really is my bag." He said, "All right, can you go back on?" But then no one else got on the coach after me. So I don't know what happened to the other two bags. I think maybe they're still there. North out of Edinburgh, over the Forth Bridge, and sunset around Kinross, which was really beautiful. But after the sun had set, the coach suddenly seemed like a much less pleasant place to be. It was dark outside, there weren't many of us left, and there was only, the only lighting was those overhead reading lights, you know, that are set into the roof. They're really harsh and you couldn't turn them off. And I also got a low battery warning on my phone and on my laptop at the same time. We got into Inverness and I went to find my B&B. Now, I had looked to see if Mrs. Law or her family still run a bed and breakfast in Inverness, but no luck. I got into my room and I put all of my electronic devices onto charge. Although I was aware as I did that spending a lot of the journey catching up with email and on Twitter and Facebook on my phone, I was probably not in the spirit of my granddad's original journey. He would have read a newspaper, read a book, and just talk to people mainly. But he would also have started writing his postcards and his letters quite early on. And if he'd written a letter to me, which I'm sure he would have done, he would have written it in code with some puzzles in it that I would have had to decipher to figure out what he was going on about. And he was a great puzzle setter, actually. I've got one of his best ones here that I thought you might be able to help me with. I've got enough of these for one each if you want, but if you're feeling competitive, but if you're feeling more cooperative, then you can work in teams, that's okay. So if you just pass those back and we'll see how many we need. Do you want to go individual, solo or team?
Solo.
Solo.
We're going
team.
Should we go team? Should we go team?
You probably got has everyone got one who needs one?
Yeah,
we're okay. I'll give you a minute. I'd start with the acrosses if I were you. I think they're slightly less difficult than the downs. Has anyone done it yet? Has anyone got any answers at all?
I've got one answer.
What answer have you? What answer have you got?
Number two down.
Flock.
Flock.
I told you to start with the acrosses, didn't I? I'm afraid flock is incorrect.
Is one across punch?
One across a puppet punch. Yes, correct.
Five down. But I was way off. I got sooty.
Sooty is actually the most popular answer.
Is it?
I think, yeah. But punch is the correct one. I'll give you an extra clue because one of them is a bit unfair because the magazine is out of print now.
And they all
is a satirical magazine called Punch. Yeah, named after the puppet, in fact. They're all punch. A drink, well, a drink is punch. A whole punch. And a blow is punch. Punch for all of the acrosses. hang on. How does that work for the downs? What kind of crazy talk is that? Because for the for vegetables, you'd have a load of peas. For the sheep, you'd have a load of ewes. Birds are ends. Oceans, seas. That's not technically correct, is it, the ocean, seas one? Geographically speaking, that is incorrect. And the H's are often dropped from the ends. That was pretty. You did pretty good then. After the first clue, that was pretty fast. You two, winners on the front row.
Damn it.
I need the clipboards back and the pencils. But if you want to keep the quiz sheet to torment your friends, that's allowed. Just don't tell anyone else in Sheffield the answers until after tomorrow night.
Sorry, I filled it in out of habit.
No, that's fine. That's fine. I've got it. So the next morning, I walked down into the centre of Inverness, over the footbridge, across the Riverness, and down to the bus station, where I was looking for the 804 from Inverness to Durness, which is the longest bus route in Britain. 5.5 hours stopping bus service goes from Inverness right across to the west coast to Ullapool, and then north to Durness. The bus itself isn't much bigger than this. It was already waiting at the bus stop. The driver was in his seat and he just waved me on because he was chatting to someone. There was another guy on the bus, a guy in his 60s, dressed in tweed, very smart looking bloke. And I sat on the second row and I could hear some of what the driver was saying in his conversation. And I heard him say to the other guy, "You know that Les? He died." And then the strange thing was, the guy he was talking to didn't acknowledge that he knew anyone called Les and didn't ask how Les had died. He just carried on talking about whatever else they'd been talking about, like the timetable changes or something. And so the driver tried again. He said, "Yeah, that Les, he died." And the other bloke still didn't acknowledge that he knew Les, and he just kind of finished what they were talking about and wandered off. And I kind of felt sorry for the driver because he'd obviously wanted to talk about it. But then he turned his attention to us, me and the other passenger. We both bought a £26.50 return to Durness, and then we set off. So, the 804 from Inverness to Durness. It's the longest bus route in Britain, 5.5 hours. And we ran exactly to timetable, because no one else got on or off the bus for the entire journey. And the driver talked to us all the way to Durness. As soon as we pulled out of the bus station, he pointed out the window and said, "Look, that's just the first of the many rainbows that we'll see today." And he was right. He told us that the first leg of the journey, which is west out of Inverness, that's his least favourite bit of the journey, because that's just mile after mile of wilderness. We talked about Tesco towns, which are Scottish towns where Tesco has built a supermarket on the outskirts and slowly the town centre dies. The problem's much worse, he says, in towns with a low crime rate, because the empty shops don't get vandalised, and so it takes much longer to see the damage getting done. We talked about the price of meat and how people should just get used to paying the cost that meat actually costs to produce, shouldn't they? We talked about our kids. He has a son and a daughter. I've got two girls. We talked about the driver's accent, which is Aberdeen via Australia. We talked about the Brummie, who was on the bus the day before. And so we also talked about my accent, which is a black country accent, and how that's very different to a Brummie accent. And that's a very important distinction to remember, if you're from the black country anyway. We talked about the panini van that was waiting for us at Loch Inver, where the driver was planning to have his lunch. So I started planning to have my lunch at the panini van as well. We talked about Bonsai Islands, which are the islands you see in the middle of Scottish lochs that are really overgrown, rich with foliage. And they are home to certain species of plants that only grow on those islands because there aren't any sheep on them to eat them as seedlings. And because they're so overgrown, the trees on them, they grow smaller than full size, so they look like bonsais. When we got into Ullapool over on the west coast, the driver said, "That's it. That's the last of the arable land. The last of the land affected by people." In Ullapool, we'd got a 15-minute break. It was really raining, so I just ran into the ferry port looking for coffee. And there was a big flat-screen TV in the corner showing the weather forecast, but with the sound turned off. And so a bunch of us gathered around the TV trying to understand the weather forecast just from the pictures. Turned out not to be that difficult, actually. It was going to rain and rain and rain. Back in the bus, north out of Ullapool, and the driver said, "That's it, we're leaving Tesco territory now. Now it's spa country all the way to the north coast. We talked about how in Scotland now, all of the road signs are written in English and in Gaelic. Even around Caithness, which is weird, isn't it? Because they never spoke Gaelic in Caithness. They spoke Norse in Caithness. Why aren't the road signs in Caithness written in Norse as well? The driver wanted to know. By this point, I had explained to the driver where I was going and why. And he said, well, brilliant. If you get to Cape Wrath and you meet the woman who lives there, ask her if the story about the turkey is true. And I said, what? Woman who lives there, what's the turkey story? And the driver said, well, there's a couple who live at Cape Wrath. And the story, locally, or in the north of Scotland anyway, is that the previous Christmas Eve, she'd gone out to buy their Christmas turkey. It had snowed, she got stranded, and she didn't get back for Christmas Day. And I said, that is brilliant. I will ask if I'm... I mean, it probably wasn't brilliant for her at the time, but it's a brilliant story, and if I meet her, I will ask her. When we got to Lochinver, the panini van wasn't there. Panini lady was on holiday for the week. Garage sandwiches all round. Rubbish. That last leg of the journey, the main road sort of winds up north up the west coast of Scotland, but the 804 itself has to turn off the main road a few times and go down into a little town or village to their one bus stop, turn round and then go back and rejoin the main road. The driver told me that what he'd like to do one of these summers is come back with his family in his car and drive the bus route, but take all of the turnings he's not allowed to take when he's driving the bus and see what's at the end of those. Despite the weather forecast, when we got into Durness, it was a beautiful sunny afternoon. And the driver didn't bother with the bus stop. He took me to the door of my hostel. So I went to check in. Now, I actually had to check in the hotel next to the hostel because they own it. But then I went through to the hostel and I got a dorm to myself so I could choose whichever bunk I wanted. So, of course, I chose a top bunk closest to the window. But I put all of my stuff on the bottom bunk underneath just to stop anyone else choosing that in case they arrived while I was out. And then I thought I'd go for an explore as it was a nice day. And there was a guy in the hostel doing maintenance work. Although, weirdly, this guy looked exactly like the guy who checked me in the hotel half an hour earlier, but just wearing an overall now. Anyway, he said, if you go west, you'll get to Balnakeel Bay, and that's worth seeing. So I set off walking, and after about a mile and a half, I got to Balnakeel Craft Village, that you'll remember from the maps. And this is a set of World War II bunkers that have now been converted into artist studios and furniture restorers, and a very nice coffee shop called Cocoa Mountain. It's called Cocoa Mountain because they also sell artisan handmade chocolates made in an open kitchen on the premises. I always think it's important to support independent local businesses, so I bought some artisan handmade chocolates. They were very nice, but by the time I'd finished eating them, it had started to rain, so I decided to walk back to the hostel. But by the time I got back to the hostel, it had stopped raining. So I carried on walking east and I got to Sango Bay with its award-winning beach. I know it's got an award-winning beach because there's a sign on it that says award-winning beach. And then it started to rain again, properly this time. And I was practically blown back up the hill to the hostel. And I got so wet and so cold so quickly that I kind of got a bit hysterical with myself in the street, like laughing out loud at myself at how ill-prepared I was for this weather. And when I got back into the hostel, I discovered that I had forgotten to pack any waterproof trousers or any tea bags. Beginner's mistake. Took all of my wet clothes off and I hung them in the drying room and I went and put on my pyjamas, even though it was only 5 o'clock in the afternoon. Two guys had arrived while I was out though, Bob and Tim, and they made me a cup of tea, bless them. And Bob and Tim were there to recce a cycle ride they wanted to do the following year. The following summer, they were going to cycle from Cape Wrath all the way down to Dover for their 65th birthdays. They'd already done Land's End to John O'Groats twice. Bit bored of that one now. I told them about a guy I'd heard about who'd cycled from the southernmost point of Britain to the easternmost point, to the westernmost point, to the northernmost point in a big zigzag. And Bob laughed and said, we'll do that for our 70th. Bob also told me that that day the Cape Wrath ferry hadn't run because of the weather. the Cape Wrath ferry runs twice a day, usually, over the Kyle of Durness, once at 11 in the morning and then again in the afternoon. But if they can't run it in the morning because of the weather, they don't bother trying to run it in the afternoon. So I basically got one chance the next day to get across the water and get to Cape Wrath. So I went to bed and I lay in my bunk, the top bunk, which was very close to the corrugated roof, and I listened to the rain. And it was still raining at whatever time I finally got to sleep. But in the morning, it had stopped, and it was a beautiful sunny day. I went through to the kitchen to find that Bob and Tim had gone, but they'd left me a pile of 6 tea bags, just in case. The weather forecast, though, was still saying rain and storms were coming, so I phoned the ferry people to find out if the boat was going to run. They said there's no way of knowing in advance, because even though it's only 2 miles away, the weather at the Kyle of Durness can be completely different to the weather in Durness itself. The only way to know is to be at the ferry port at 11 o'clock and see if the boat runs. Well, I'd got plenty of time, so I thought I would walk to the ferry port and I would go and get myself some waterproof trousers on the way, just in case. So I went down to the Spa General Store and Post Office, which is run by a guy who looks exactly like the guy who'd been doing the maintenance. I think this one bloke just does all of the jobs in Durness. I don't know what everyone else does for a living. But he got one set of waterproof trousers left, and they were too small for me. But I thought, better safe, better to have an overly snug pair than none. So I bought them, but I didn't put them on because it was a nice day, so I set off walking. But after an hour, after a mile, inevitably, I suppose, it started to rain. And I thought about that first story of my granddad's journey, where he'd hitchhiked. And I used to hitchhike quite a lot as a student. And I also knew that anything coming past me would also be going past the ferry port. So I thought it was worth a try. So I put my thumb out when I heard something coming. And the first thing was a big white 4x4. And as it got closer, I could see that hanging from its rear view mirror, there was a pair of white frilly knickers. Kind of lost enthusiasm with my thumb a little bit, and I kind of didn't mind when they didn't stop. The next thing though was a little white van with just the driver in it, so I thought, that's a banker, that is, and I put my thumb out. And the driver saw me. Have any of you done any hitchhiking? Yeah, a little bit, yeah, a couple of you. Okay, well, you'll probably recognise this. If you haven't done any hitchhiking, there's a gesture that drivers do to hitchhikers that means, I've seen you, I've seen that you've seen me see you, and I want you to know, or at least think, that I do usually pick up hitchhikers, but I can't pick you up today, even though I've got an empty passenger seat because of this really good but complicated reason I've got. This is the gesture, in case you ever need it. Packs a lot of meaning into quite a small movement, I always think. The wonder of communication. That's what the driver did to me anyway. And he just sped past. And by this point, I was properly wet again. And I know from experience that once you're wet, you don't get a lift. They don't want you in the car once you're wet. So I took a shortcut through a very wet field, past some very wet sheep, down to the ferry port. Now, I'm calling it a ferry port, but what it actually is a little wooden jetty that goes out over the water. And at the top of the jetty, there is a rain shelter like you get at a bus stop. And the rain shelter was completely chock-a-block full of people dressed head to toe in really expensive looking waterproof clothing. They'd even got these little waterproof coats for their backpacks. Little separate backpack waterproof coats. I'd got this, which although it is a backpack, it's actually a laptop bag and it's absorbent rather than waterproof. Even though my jeans were already wet, I thought I'd better put my waterproof trousers on, my new waterproof trousers, which were too small for me, and they're not my first choice of colour or pattern, I have to admit. I wasn't completely ill-prepared, though. I do have a waterproof coat, and it's quite a good one. But it happens to be green, so once I've got these on, I basically looked like a badly prepared survivalist. But once I had struggled into these in the rain, the interesting thing was the waterproof people all shuffled to the side a little bit and made room for me in the rain shelter. And once I'd got into the rain shelter, that's when I realised that parked up next to it was the little white van that hadn't given me a lift. and it would turn out that the guy driving that was going to be our minibus driver. It's his job to give people a lift, and I was one of his customers. Parked up next to him was our ferryman. And as he got out of his car and he walked past the rain shelter, and he was cursing God for the weather as he went past. He went down onto the jetty and he got into this little red plastic boat that he took out onto the water. And he swapped that for a slightly bigger blue plastic boat. And as he brought that back to the jetty, it stopped raining. And it was so windy that the clouds just cleared from the sky in a matter of minutes, and we had a beautiful morning. No one had said anything to us, but me and the waterproof people, we shuffled down onto the jetty. And then half of us got into the boat, because the boat isn't big enough to take everyone for the minibus in one go. Half of you have to go over, and then, well, half of you wait, and then half of you have to wait over there while the boat comes back and gets the other. If that's your business, you get a boat big enough to take everyone for the minibus in one go, don't you? And the other thing they need to get is they need a ticket booth, because they can't sell you a ticket before you get in the boat. They wait till you're in the boat and you're halfway across the water in an open-top boat in a howling gale. Then the guy who's meant to be driving the boat turns around and starts selling you your tickets, paper money for tickets. That is a disaster waiting to happen, that is. I refrained from sharing my business acumen with them, though. I just shut up and got in the second boat. I was last onto the minibus and I sat in this seat here, right at the back. And then the driver set off at quite a pace up that single track road. And he obviously fancied himself as a bit of a tour guide, because he'd got a lot to tell us. He said, right, so the first thing you need to know today, the good news, I suppose, is that the Ministry of Defence aren't firing. So I don't have to dodge any ammunition cells on the way. The other thing you need to know is about pronunciation. We're going to Cape Wrath. A lot of people call it Cape Wrath, and they think it's because the sea is angry or something like that. But it isn't. Wrath is a Norse word that means turning point. It's the place where the Vikings realised they couldn't get their boats any further around Scotland, and they had to turn round and go back. Cape Wrath means the place where you turn round and go home. Mm. You see these ruined buildings, they've all been painted with a sort of a black and white check pattern. That's to help out the American Air Force, because they really are a terrible shot. And this bridge we're about to, this is a temporary bridge that they built about 25 years ago, but I'm sure it's still strong enough to take the minibus, so it was fine yesterday. And those cliffs over there, over to our right, they're the highest cliffs in Britain. Yeah, I know you all thought it was Beachy Head in England, but the highest cliffs in Britain are up here in Scotland. And this lighthouse, the Cape Wrath Lighthouse, this was the last staffed lighthouse in Britain, but now it's automated, just like all of them. Before you get off the minibus, there are some things you need to know. Directly west of here, there's no land until Canada. Directly north of here, there's nothing until the Arctic Circle. Directly east of here, there's a little bit of Scotland, but after that, there's no land until Norway. When you get off the minibus, please remember that the cliffs are very high, the wind is very strong, the grass is very slippery when it's wet, and there are no railings. Please be very careful at the cliff edge, because I would like to take all of you back to the boat. And then he told us that he would give us our tickets when we got off. The minibus, and they just kind of milled around by the side of the door for a bit, or they went straight into the cafe to get a cup of tea. But I ran straight up to the lighthouse and took photographs of it, and I ran around the lighthouse and took photographs of the big red foghorn that's round the back, no longer in use. And then I climbed down into the structure underneath the foghorn, which is about as far out over the cliffs as you can get, and I took photographs of the view directly north and directly northwest. And then I realised that what I was doing, so I was running around documenting the experience of being there, rather than having the experience of being there. And I thought about my granddad, and I went and I sat on the cliff, and I looked at the sea, and I thought about how far down it was, and how it was quite windy up on the cliff, and how I was actually a bit frightened. And I decided to go in to get a cup of tea. Everyone else had come out of the cafe by this point. So I went to the hatch at the end and I asked the guy for a cup of tea. And while he was making it, a woman came through into the kitcheny bit. And you know when you can just tell that people don't just work together? I could tell these two were a couple. And so I said, sorry, but do you live here? And the woman said, yeah, we do. There used to be 17 families on this peninsula and a little school, but now it's just us. And I said, what's it like? Is it brilliant? And the woman looked at me and she said, well, it has its moments. Mm-hmm. And then I took my cup of tea outside and I looked at the sea from a safer distance. Felt a bit less scared. But then we had to get back on the minibus almost straight away and set off. And as I sat at the back and we pulled away, I could hear the conversations that the other passengers were having. And that's when I realised that that woman was Turkey woman. Hmm. And I'd forgotten to ask her about... So I cheated. And I looked her up on the internet that night. And it's true. The previous Christmas Eve, she'd set off to get their Christmas turkey. She'd gone all the way to Inverness to get it, for some reason. I don't know why she'd had to go quite so far. But on her way back from Inverness, it started to snow. She got back as far as Durness, but by then the snow was too deep, too heavy, and she couldn't get across the water. So she stayed at a friend's house that night, and the next morning she sort of ignored the fact that it was Christmas Day, and she waited for the snow to melt. But it didn't melt. And 6 days later, a local news crew heard about her story and they offered her a helicopter ride home, which she didn't take because she's afraid of flying. And the snow didn't melt for another 2 weeks. So she didn't get home till the middle of January. But when she did get home, that's when they had their Christmas Day with the turkey that she'd brought back from Inverness and kept in a friend's freezer. I sat at the back of the minibus and I ate my sandwiches. And I kind of felt a bit deflated because I'd been looking forward to going to Cape Wrath for 3 years and it wasn't there in the future anymore. And sitting in the minibus, I realised that what this was more than anything was an act of remembrance for my granddad. And so I decided that what I would do that evening is I would go and find one of the bars that I knew he'd had a drink in Durness, and I would drink a shot of his favourite whisky for him. Now, I don't like whisky. I don't really know very much about it, but I do know that my granddad's favourite whisky was Famous Grouse. And I also know that whisky aficionados aren't very impressed with that because it's a blend, not a single malt. Although I don't actually know what that means. I really know so little about whiskey. I've only discovered recently that whiskey spelt with just a Y is Scotch and whiskey spelt EY is Irish. All of my life, I've just thought I've been spelling it wrong. I suppose the other thing I know is that a Scottish measure of whiskey is a bit bigger than an English measure. I think I'm allowed to go somewhere between the two, being half and half. Is it, are any of you whiskey drinkers? Yeah, very enthusiastic. So, well, you might have to guide me as to what I don't know. Such an enthusiastic whiskey drinker, that's the wrong person to ask what a shot is, isn't it? Yeah, fill the glass.
I don't know what a Scottish measure is.
Does that look like a, is that a good whiskey?
Okay,
for that,
yeah.
Is that,
okay. Like an hour.
So, this is the joke that I told at my granddad's funeral. The Romans are guarding Hadrian's Wall, and one afternoon, on a hill just north of Hadrian's Wall, a piper appears and starts playing the bagpipes. The centurion thinks that's a bit cheeky, so he sends two of his soldiers to go and sort the piper out. And he watches as they go up the hill, but the piper sees them coming, and he disappears over the brow of the hill, and the two Roman soldiers follow. 5 minutes later, the piper reappears and starts playing the pipes again. Centurion thinks that's a bit odd, so he sends six of his men to find out what's happened. And he watches as they go up the hill. The piper sees them coming, disappears over the brow of the hill, and the six Roman soldiers disappear after him. 10 minutes later, the piper's back playing the pipe, so the centurion sends 20 of his men, and the same thing happens. And by now, he's furious. So he sends the rest of his garrison, and he watches them charge up the hill. The piper sees them coming, disappears over the brow of the hill, and all of the Roman soldiers follow. 20 minutes later, the piper's back playing tune on his pipes, and one Roman soldier reappears, clearly mortally wounded, and he staggers down the hill, down to Hadrian's Wall, and he gets to the centurion and he says, Centurion. Centurion. It was a trap. There were two of them. That's the short version of that joke. My granddad could spin that out for half an hour if you let him. You know, in all but one of my memories of my granddad, he's bigger than me, taller and broader. This used to be his suit. When I first borrowed it when I was 19, it was way too big. Still too long in the leg. You see at the front, I have to wear it with turn-ups. He didn't. I seem to have filled the jacket out a bit as I've got older, but mainly around the waist rather than the chest. But in my last memory of my granddad, he's smaller than me. Smaller than himself. He was unshaven, which was unusual for him. And he'd stopped getting out of bed. Too much effort by this point. And I don't know why, but I feel I should be able to say that I knew, I understood at the time that this would be the last time that I saw him alive. But I didn't. Cheers, Grandad. It's always like 2 seconds where you think it's going to be all right this time. Slowly acquiring a taste, but only very slowly. Letter number 2. 22nd of September, 1988. He sleeps on the bottom bunk in a room with 3 others, all lone cyclists going their separate ways the next day. And although he rests, he doesn't sleep too well. Sore legs and an overactive brain keep him from a sound sleep. The next morning, he's last to rise. Tea, 2 boiled eggs, 2 slices of toast, and Robertson's ginger preserve. He does his job, wiping down 6 tables and 36 chairs. He sets off for Smoo Cave. He buys a loaf of bread on the way. It's quite a climb down to Smoo Cave and back up again, but it's worth seeing. He walks back the 3/4 of a mile past Sango Bay. He visits the Sango Bay Hotel and he sits in the bar, looking out over the cliffs to the blue sea, having a rest and a medicinal. He begins writing letter 2, but he doesn't finish it yet. He presses on through Durness to Balnakeel Craft Village, a concrete single-storey wartime campsite now whitewashed and flower planted. He picks up a leaflet detailing all of the activities offered, and he notes that people live here too. He considers that it's going to struggle to survive. He visits the Far North Hotel, an unlicensed family-run hotel with lots of books for children. He drinks tea in the sun lounge with a view of the mountains. He reads some of Wainwright's Scotland. It rains outside. He reaches Balnakeel Bay. There are spots of rain and bursts of sunshine, and there are amazing single and double rainbows. He tries to photograph them. He's 2.5 miles from the hostel, but he has no choice but to stagger back. After 1.5 miles, he falls over the step of the Sango Bay Hotel at 6 p.m. and he takes fortification. Then he resumes his journey. He thinks about cheese on toast on the square loaf that he's been carrying around with him all day. The hostel is much quieter tonight. He talks to the girl whose birthday it was yesterday. He estimates that she's 18 or 19 or 20. She's been travelling alone for 3 weeks. And he asks her what her parents think about that. She tells him that she'd started travelling with a friend, but the friend had been called home unexpectedly, and so she had a choice to carry on her own or go home too. She tells him that her sister used to work in Aberdeen and her mum had visited her sister in Aberdeen. They'd both travelled around a bit and they all thought she would be all right on her own in Scotland because they all liked it so much. And that's the end of that story. He has toasted cheese sandwiches with a scraping of tomato puree, a pint of milk, a pot of tea, and 2 squares of plain chocolate. Would anyone else like 2 squares of plain chocolate? Birmingham's finest.
Oh, yeah.
In fact, the bars are so big these days, you might get more than 2 squares. microphone, just give you that and pass it back.
Thank you.
This is from letter 3, 24th of September 1988. On Saturday morning, he's up early, but there's no one around. He cleans the cookertops and the warden makes him a cup of tea because he's short of time. He gets the 8:30 a.m. bus from Durness to Laeg in order to get off at the Cape Wrath ferry point. The driver is a man of 65 to 70 who looks just like Popeye, but without the pipe. He's constantly chewing away at nothing as he has no teeth, and from his driving, he obviously fancies himself as another Stirling Moss. It's 9 a.m. and the ferry isn't until 11. He goes for a walk across the hilltops and he finds an old fort. At 10 a.m. he goes to the Cape Wrath Hotel, which confusingly isn't at Cape Wrath, where he orders tea, toast and marmalade. To his surprise, it's beautifully done and he enjoys it very much. Although he's sure the unsmiling waitress says £1.40, she gives him £4 change from a £5 note. He's only got 4p in change, so she doesn't get a tip. He charges down to the ferry point. There is a sudden blustery shower of rain which sorts the men from the boys. Needless to say, he is one of the men smirking from inside his waterproof coat, waterproof trousers and waterproof boots. The boat is low in the choppy water and the crossing takes 15 minutes until they arrive at a small, slippery, rocky pier. They pile into a minibus. It's a 30-minute hell for leather up and down twisting run along a deep, rutted track. The Cape Wrath lighthouse is allowed out for 30 minutes, and then they are back on the minibus for the return journey. On the shore of the Kyle of Durness, he sits on a sheltered rock and he eats a lunch of two thick Orkney oat cakes, Canadian hard mature cheese, Brazil nuts, dried, ready to eat apricots, and yes, two or three squares of plain chocolate. With sun and showers, it is a splendid way to spend a Saturday. At about 5 p.m, the bus from Laeg to Durness picks him up at the roadside as arranged earlier. It drops him at the Sango Bay Hotel, where he falls through the door for a medicinal. He walks the mile up the hill back to the hostel, which he finds completely full. Two Chinese men and one Chinese woman, a new German girl, a German couple, two Londoners, three Australians, one Tasmanian male, two ladies of 65 to 70 years old and two ladies of 50 to 60 who he guesses are from Glasgow. Progress, he thinks. The old and the female are taking over. On Sunday, he's last up. He makes a breakfast of porridge, boiled egg and toast. He does his job cleaning the sinks and the worktops. It's a beautiful sunny day and he sets off east along the cliffs. He climbs back up to the Smoo Cave Hotel. It could be open, he thinks. He might get a drop of the grouse. Who knows? It is, and he does. A young couple come in. An Asian man with an English girl. And although not a deathly silence, he does notice that all chatter in the hotel bar ceases, and it's very quiet as they finish their lunch of soup and sandwiches. They leave straight away, and he follows. It started to rain, and it gets heavier. He climbs down onto the beach looking for shelter, but you can never find a cave when you need one. He finds a slab of rock, though, jutting out from the bottom of the cliff, resting on a boulder. He lies under it, and he gets out his survival bag at last to cover his legs. Half sitting, half lying, he eats a lunch of two oatcakes, cheese, Brazil nuts, dried apricot, and plain chocolate. Delicious. He sits and he looks out to sea. He thinks about his life. It will take him an hour to walk back to the hostel. He'll do his hostel job that evening to allow for an early start the next day. He'll get the 8:30 a.m. bus to Laeg again, then the 11:35 to RJ on the Wick to Inverness route. After an hour's wait at a service station, he'll pick up the express coach to Inverness. In Inverness, he'll find a payphone, and he'll telephone Mrs. Law, and he'll arrange bed and breakfast for the night. I asked my mum about the fact that my granddad didn't stay in Durness for very long. She said he never stayed anywhere for very long. It was the travelling that he liked. On my last morning in Durness, I went to visit the last couple of places I knew my granddad had been to. I climbed down to Smoo Cave, it's worth seeing. and I went and found his hostel, which is still a Youth Hostel Association hostel, but doesn't open in September anymore, so I hadn't been able to stay there. As I was packing my things, they were cleaning my hostel from top to bottom because they were expecting a wedding party, a surfer's wedding on the beach the next day. The photographer was very excited. There's a storm coming. At 3:15, I found myself at the bus stop outside the Spa General Store and Post Office, waiting for the 8:04 from Durness to Inverness. It arrived on time, and it was the same driver. We didn't get to talk as much on the way back because the bus was actually quite busy, 8 passengers. And 4 of those 8 passengers were a Canadian family who had got on the 8:04 in Inverness that morning, come all the way to Durness, got off and had their lunch, got back on the same bus for another 5 hours back to Inverness. It's a day out, they said. And it is only 5 hours on the way back, actually, the 8:04. It's half an hour quicker because the driver gets less breaks. And also because, he explained to me, on the way back, the 8:04 gets into Ullapool at 5 o'clock. And if you have a 15-minute break in Ullapool at 5 o'clock, everyone goes to the chip shop and then they all get stuck in the queue and the bus is delayed because it has to wait for everyone. So it's only 5 minutes in Ullapool on the way back. But we got in 2 minutes early and one guy made a break for it, got over through the car park to the chip shop, got himself a fish supper, got back to the bus in time, and we had to smell his chips all the way home. When we got into Inverness, I went round to talk to the driver. I asked him his name. The driver told me that his name was Alan. I told him that my name was Alex. And we shook hands and we said goodbye. And that's us about done. When you get off, I'll give you your tickets. But before we do that, I wondered if we could just tell each other our names.
Gareth,
Dave,
Tom,
Jess, Poppy,
Raffaella,
Andrew,
Carl,
Cara,
Liz,
Aina,
and I'm Alex. Goodbye.